So, and what happens is that a board maybe exists for one time, and they decide they'd like to meet at 1:30 on Thursday afternoons. And about a year later, many of the board members change, and there's new people on board, and they can't meet at that time, so they change their time that they meet. So lo and behold, their bylaws still read 1:30 Thursday afternoon, and they're meeting at Monday at 4. So in fact, those kinds of technical little things need to be updated periodically, and I'd say 5 to 10 years at least should be reviewed.
Okay.
And if you're following the bylaws, it's obvious to you when you have to update them.
Okay. Here's a question, a very basic question. This is from Terry Cox in Harlan. Somebody give a definition of bylaws.
Well, just rules and procedures, how they operate, setting forth their activities and procedures.
I'd have to say that. We have a planning and zoning handbook that Stu Huntington can find and make available to you. I think it was a handout that we gave out last year, but there's a model set of bylaws there. But essentially what you're trying to do is to allow the applicant and all affected parties to know up front how their particular request is going to be handled. You're going to have the cutoff date as to when is the last time that case can be actually submitted before the board will handle it, how special meetings can be handled, what should be the basic outline for the agenda of that particular meeting of the Board of Adjustment, and then can the applicant come back again with the same type of request 30 days from now? So all those kinds of things that relate strictly to the procedural aspects of the Board of Adjustment need to be put down on paper.
Okay. Question from Decatur. Is an environmental impact statement necessary for a zoning change? Is that a law in Iowa as it is in California, as was mentioned in the video?
They picked up something that I missed. Yeah, that would just be a California statute. It's not not an Iowa requirement.
Okay. Question from Joe Burham in Cedar Falls. Does avoidance of ex parte communication prevent a Board of Adjustment member from investigating sites and discussing the general area with affected persons?
That's kind of a tough question. I would strongly advise the Board of Adjustment members to get out there in the field, if you might want to say, and really analyze the problem. But in doing so, when you talk with the adjoining property owners, everything that you learn in the way of information must be then given to the other members of the board. So I'm not discouraging you from doing that. And in fact, what you may want to do is inform your zoning administrator to go out and obtain some of that information and present it in an organized fashion to all of the board members.
Okay. We have a question for you, Duane. This is from Diane Alborn in Ida Grove. She says, presently we are in a situation where a subdivision was established in 1975 when no county planning commission existed. The city approved the subdivision for light industrial use. Now we have county planning and zoning commission. This is a two-pager. And the land is approved by the city within 2 miles of the city limit. When the county planning and zoning commission established the map, the property was listed suburban agricultural. The owner wants to sell property for light industrial. You've looked at this, so you know how to answer this, I hope. The owner wants to sell in property for light industrial, and he needs a change because it's listed as agricultural suburban. The county zoning commission referred it to the city and left the action as it was in 1975. However, they did not record the 1975 subdivision plat, hence exists as suburban agricultural. The owner wants the rest of the property changed to light industrial. The city referred this back to the county, and the county is presently deciding. As well, housing was established beside the land, hence the owners of the housing don't want land changed to light industrial. Question: what alternatives exist to assist both homeowners and the use of land as light industrial, buffer zones, that sort of thing? Good question. Took us a bit to get there, but it is a good question.
Well, first off,
very pertinent.
The fact that the subdivision plat, even though it was approved, was never filed, wasn't consummated, and so it doesn't really exist. It was just an action and really didn't become material over the long term. And the question about putting it in light industrial use so that it can be sold for light industrial property is a zone change, not a subdivision issue. The use of the land is related to the subdivision ordinance, not the zoning ordinance. Now, if it is in light industrial, and is going to be developed as light industrial, then there are standards and design principles that relate to the industrial site. For example, you don't have curbs, gutters, and sidewalks. You have streets that drain into the center, and those contrast in street standards are very significant. But I would say you're at square one in terms of looking at zone change for light industrial.
Okay. Question from John Page in Cedar Falls. Is it wise to have a city attorney present at all planning and zoning commission and board of adjustment meetings? Is this practice typical or not in Iowa?
Well, the city attorney certainly, or the county attorney, can be a very helpful person. It's not, however, terribly common to have them attending all meetings. Basically, these are lay groups. They have responsibilities, and they're appointed to do certain functions, and they can, in difficult matters, they can certainly refer to that person. But I would say it would be rather unusual to have them have the attorney there for all meetings.
For all meetings, okay. Question from Eagle Grove. Why are new subdivisions allowed to exist without sidewalks? Comment from someone.
Be a matter of the local way the local regulations are drafted. It's certainly an amenity that that families, people with children, would want to have in a neighborhood. And my own personal view is that it's something that should be included in subdivision regulations. But again, it's a local determination.
This is the sidewalk issue.
Yeah,
the sidewalk is a hard play surface for children. It's very important for child safety that they play on the sidewalk and not in the street. But we know that in certain large lot tracks and so forth, having a sheet overflow without curbs, gutters, and sidewalks often is a very satisfactory way of handling stormwater and is a cheaper way of doing business and providing the subdivision. So it's a matter of where it's occurring and how many children you have and what kind of safety issue you have.
Okay. Question from Manchester. Should a survey be required before any matter brought before a board of adjustment for a design, or rather for a decision affecting the setback requirement? Should a survey be required?
I think what they're really asking is, you know, how heavily should you weight the opinion of the people in the neighborhood? My own feeling is that's a factor, but your primary concern should be the comprehensive plan, implementing that, and not necessarily taking a popular vote on every issue. That's really not what the process is all about.
Okay.
I'd agree.
Okay. From Dubuque, a question. Must a specific zoning district identified in the zoning ordinance text exist on the zoning map? In other words, if the district is listed in the text but not on the map, is it legal? Is it possible that, according to the caller this time, this use may exist in the future?
It's an unusual situation. I wonder if they're referring to some sort of floating zone. That's a kind of a new technique that's been used. Most traditional types of zoning, you'd not have that situation.
For example, it may be something like a planned commercial development, which says that it floats over the city and it applies where you have at least 5 acres of land that is adjacent to existing commercial zoning, and those are conditions that have to be met in order to pull that 5 acres down and say this is planned commercial. But that's a section of the zoning ordinance, but it isn't on the map.
Mm-hmm. I guess from a legal standpoint, I would get concerned if I had a zoning district that was listed as a district, but there was nothing actually within the community that actually was designated for that, because one of the overall legal principles that always comes along with zoning ordinances is that you must provide for all forms of land use. And here, if you've got a potential land use and it is provided for in the ordinance, maybe theoretically you are providing for it, but if it's not on paper, you might be challenged in court. But the whole issue is that whether or not that use is somehow allowed within your community, it needs to be done. If it's not specifically shown on your map, you know, I would think that one should be giving that some ideas to where would be the most appropriate place for that, and then maybe zoning at that.
Okay, very good. Question from Jim Stansberry over in Marshalltown. This question is regarding covenants in a subdivision. First question, who originates them? Second, how long are they in effect? third, how do you get outdated ones removed? And I think this question, I guess, could go to you, Duane.
And the restrictive covenant that they're talking about is imposing some special requirement on the property in the real estate transaction, and it's recorded with the deed. And state law in Iowa, as I recall, is 20 years that's in effect. It can be used to control such things as accessory buildings on lots and things of that nature. In terms of taking care of those, normally they're associated with a homeowners association, which means that there's some body that has a decision to make over whether they stay or whether they're removed. But they pertain to the particular piece of property in its deed.
Okay. A question from Charles Hinkle. It's from Humboldt, I think. They're watching in the Fort Dodge office. Resented to file 136, an update. At this time, reads, the Board of Supervisors may appoint itself as a Board of Adjustment and or affirm, modify, or reverse the decision of the Board of Adjustments. At this time, it's a law. Can the courts do this?
Right. I guess I brought up Senate File 136, and I checked just this morning with the bill room in Des Moines, and they told me it was on the calendar for debate. The thing to remember here is that local authority still reigns. The elected officials, if this is indeed law, the elected officials will make that determination whether they want to hold on to that special exception power themselves or pass it on to the Board of Adjustment.
Okay, very good. From Joe Sellers in Sheraton, does the state of Iowa have a comprehensive land use plan for the year 2000? Does it deal with landfills and waste disposal? Is this mandated on the state, local, or federal level?
There is no such plan. In Iowa, the state has passed through most planning and zoning authority to the local government in a voluntary fashion, just simply enabling that planning to take place at the local level. So there's really nothing like that on the state level that I'm aware of.
You want to comment on the process we went through with the counties having to do land use plans or inventories?
Sure.
In the last 5 years? Basically, they had that option, whether it was a plan or whether it was an inventory, and so different counties did things differently, and there was no consistency over the whole state. You couldn't aggregate it into a state plan, but it was still the county rule over land use.
Mm-hmm. Roger, it did sound like this question related a lot to solid waste disposal and so forth. And while I'm not a real close authority on it, I know that the Department of Natural Resources is going out and actually providing funds, I believe it's from the federal or the state level, down to local regions where a regional solid waste disposal plan is required by a certain date within a couple of years. I'm not sure the technicalities of it, but in fact, all of those regional plans then will be put together and be combined into one state plan.
Okay, very good. Question from Martin Boston in Atlantic. Should a financial hardship be considered in the review of a variance or a conditional use request? Can it be considered as an allowable hardship?
Well, I have a kind of a dual answer to that. Financial consideration is only one element in the review of the process. And I would have to call it a rather minor element, because as we've discussed earlier this evening, the variance goes with the land. It doesn't go with the individual. And frankly, I don't know anybody out here, particularly in these tough economic times in Iowa, that wouldn't be able to plead for financial hardship for every one of their requests. And if we used financial as the bottom line as to whether to approve or deny a variance, I think every variance would be approved. And so the Board of Adjustment really has to be careful not to be persuaded to grant a variance based on financial difficulties alone. I think in greater detail we need to look at the physical characteristics of the land and how that proposed development fits on that particular piece of ground.
There's always a financial consideration, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
And then when we look at the land, it's going to affect the price of the individual piece of property because mm-hmm. of the hardship that's associated with it. And how much are you damaged by that? That's important to know, but it's not the turning point.
Okay. Jim Vanderweel over in Pelham ask a question. If a city uses extraterritorial jurisdiction, should they include a section of regulation in their zoning ordinance? What criteria can be used to approve or reject a developer's proposal?
In terms of zoning, the city has the authority to go out 2 miles only if the county is not zoned. And about that would be about a third of our counties in Iowa that are not zoned. Those cities, if they have zoning, may take those powers out further. They would have to, in their ordinance, do that as a part of their ordinance.
Mm-hmm. I wanted to make something, I think, clear to this individual down in Pella, and that is that you have to be very careful about treating people in the unincorporated area differently than you do within your community. If you have an R1 zoning district, that should be applicable both within the city of Pella and within the 2 mile area if that's what Pella chooses to use. And again, I need to reiterate so other people don't get confused. This is only in counties that don't have county zoning. Cities have the ability if they pass the ordinance. But you know, in summarizing it, I don't think that there should be a special residential out in the unincorporated area versus the standard residential within town or a special commercial in the unincorporated area. They may want to have a suburban residential zoning district that may be like an R3 large lot, but that could be available both within the city or within the 2 miles, and they have to be very careful about treating the unincorporated people differently.
In terms of subdivision, when you go to the 2 mile limit, you have a different kind of consideration. It has to come under the city subdivision standards, and that's where we normally get hook up to the sanitary sewer, curbs, gutters, mm-hmm. sidewalks, and things of this nature. And when the city draws a line and says the extent of our urban services is a different line than that 2 mile limit, where the 2 mile limit includes territory that's not in the urban services, the city should be waiving that and let it come under county review. Septic tanks without curbs, gutters, and sidewalks.
Okay, question from Dubuque and Paul Boss in Dubuque. How are quarries handled? A special use permit or what? What sites do counties most often approve for salvage yards? We got a couple of questions. What mm-hmm. special characteristics do they have? Let's take the quarries first. Dubuque, a gravelly area.
I guess from what I've learned from talking with other counties is that quarries are usually a rather unique type of land use, and so they could technically be categorized as a special exception or a special use permit and then handled by the Board of Adjustment as a unique case that's being proposed on this particular site if it's listed within that zoning district. They have to make sure that it is already listed there. So quarries, frankly, in most counties are rather limited. There aren't very many of them. So maybe a special use permit is the best idea.
Okay.
Others could possibly be under heavy manufacturing, in which case sure. any zoning district like that would be able to handle it.
There are a whole bunch of obnoxious uses.
Yeah.
And we take care of them by the special use or conditional use. And when you have one that is, they said you permit it within that zone, and then you specify all of the conditions or in effect set forth a basis for determining those conditions, in effect you're saying we will permit it if the conditions are met. And so when the applicant shows compliance with those conditions, you in effect are bound to go ahead and give that use, permitted use.
Okay. Here's an opinion from Pat Quinn in Dubuque on Senate 136. If a planning decision is passed by a political official, is this better than an unelected position?
Well, it's certainly different. The Board of Adjustment, the initial thinking was that the Board of Adjustment would handle these difficult problems that come up because of the dynamics mm-hmm. in land use. And part of the thinking also was to separate those from political decisions. There's some feeling evidently in the legislature and other places that some of those decisions should perhaps be made by elected officials who in some respects are more accountable to the people. So it's just a different approach, yeah. A different philosophy. And again, the cities and counties will get to make that choice how they want those handled.
Okay. We do have a clear distinction between two types of actions. One's legislative and the other one's administrative. If it's a legislative action like a change of zoning, you have to make that by the Board of Supervisors or the City Council in the final analysis. And a lot of them are administrative, and the variances and the exceptions mm-hmm. that we're talking about are of administrative nature.
Okay. Sylvia Roba in Davenport. I like this question very much. It's on citizen input. What can you do beyond hearings?
Well, hearings are certainly the most common way of getting citizen input, and I still think hearing has value. If you get the word out and get people to show up, I think sometimes we almost hope that no one comes, and that's the wrong approach. We need to get people involved, and I think there's a number of other things mm-hmm. You can use the media. Phil talked about that a little bit to get people informed and aware. A lot of cities and counties are now putting up an actual sign on the property to make sure that people understand what's contemplated in terms of a zoning change. So I think there are things that people can do to get more citizen input.
Stu, maybe one thing that I could also suggest, and again, this is one of those difficult things that may take a long time to get established, but where you see changes slowly occurring within a neighborhood, you may want to try to develop a grassroots neighborhood association, some kind of a task force that meets, that's made up of businessmen, made up of professionals in that area, made up of people who live in that area, who have roots in that area, who want to see that area prosper. And then hopefully based on some grassroots neighborhood, I don't think policy development, then they can go with the guidance of the city, try to make some inroads as to what to do about the problem areas within their neighborhood. Rather than having it all done at one public meeting, at one particular rezoning or whatever, where there's more likely to be a negative reaction rather than a grassroots support mm-hmm. of how can we improve this neighborhood? Difficult, takes time to establish, but it's one other way to handle it.
Okay. Question from Sac City, Shirley Phillips. One question, our county is not zoned due to apprehension of rural residents. What are the advantages or disadvantages of countywide zoning?
As I mentioned before, there are about a third of the counties in Iowa that have chosen not to adopt local zoning. There are some concerns, evidently, in those places about people's independence, people's use of their land. On the plus side, I think the thing that zoning clearly does, particularly as development occurs and as more people come into an area, is provide protection for landowners and separate uses that are incompatible. Comments?
Hog confinement near Ledges State mm-hmm. Park. I was in Boone County without a zoning ordinance, and it was of such an issue that people were talking about a separate state law just to deal with hog confinement. And if we took every land use that was in the book and started talking about a state law that dealt with that particular use, we would have a big code. And so what we need is something that sorts out what's permitted in what areas, everything in its place.
Okay. The second question is real quick. Will Iowa law mandate that all counties be zoned?
There was such a proposal during this legislative term. It was defeated. Whether or not that will happen in the future, I guess my own feeling is that'd be a few years down the road. But that's just my crystal ball.
My feeling is, Stu, and again, it's because I've been at the county level as long as I have, that I do not feel that counties should be mandated to make up land use controls. Because normally when they're forced to do something, they'll either put a boilerplate ordinance in there that they really don't really believe in their hearts, and therefore it's not administered or changed, and it's a meaningless regulation. Mm-hmm. Or in fact, some other big waste of time is done to raise the ire of the local people. My feeling is that it's up to the local people when they desire to start protecting their land policy or their land properties, and when they want to guide the changes or growth within their county, that they themselves will go ahead and decide that they want to have a zoning ordinance. It doesn't have to be a big fancy one. It can be very simple.
Okay.
But I think that it would be, in my opinion, it would be wrong for the state to require or mandate county zoning.
We have some counties that are doing land evaluation and site assessment for the purpose of performance measure of conversion of agricultural land to urban development. And that process allows the local county officials to calibrate by weighting their factors so that it can either favor ag land preservation or favor urban development depending upon their needs. Story County has it, Johnson, Lynn, Blackhawk, do you have it in Scott?
Not exactly in that form.
But we have several counties that are using it.
Okay. Phil, question for you. Is a Board of Adjustment necessary in a town of 1,500?
Believe it or not, a Board of Adjustment is needed the day that you adopt your zoning ordinance, even if you've got 100 people living in your community.
Okay.
Could I just add one thing, which is in the very small towns, there is a provision in the Iowa Code, and it's found in Chapter 414.24. It's called Restricted Residence Zoning. And in that case, the very small towns, the city council takes care of all zoning matters, and they don't have the Board of Adjustment and the other groups, and that works well for some of the smaller places.
Okay, I wish I had time to go through all the rest of these questions. We're about out of time. I'll ask one more. Should the Planning Commission ask for a recommendation from the Planning Director on each issue before the Commission?
I think yes. You've got this person there as a resource. It doesn't mean you go with that opinion every time, but yes, get that input along with the other things you're looking at.
Okay. Thank you all for being part of this. We will answer your questions. We will get to you. We have the addresses and or telephone numbers for all of the questions that were asked, and we'll do our very best, or Stu will. I won't.
Right.
Stu will.
I will do that.
To answer your questions. We'd like to acknowledge a couple of folks that were very instrumental in making sure this all fit together. Miriam Simmons, of course, from the Continuing Education Office here at Iowa State, and Carol Seifert, folks that I talk to almost on a daily basis, and Mary Holtz Claus and Carrie Gibson, who took care of the fine printed material, much of which was in your packet. We'll do this again. Did you like it? It worked.
I enjoyed it very much, and I hope other people did as well. There are a couple little forms. If people could just take a minute to look at those, we would like to get your evaluations if you could.
Okay.
And then if you want more information, let me know. There's a form to request that.
This is the guy to ask. Thanks to all our participants. Take care. Have a good day tomorrow. I'm Roger Brown.